Good morning.
Good morning.
Our service of Holy Eucharist, Rite 1, begins with hymn 686. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 3. Please stand. Son and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit. We may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ saith. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace to men. We worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord, thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God.
God, who hast taught us to keep all thy commandments by loving thee and our neighbor, grant us the grace of thy Holy Spirit, that we may be devoted to thee with our whole heart and united to one another with pure affection, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
The Old Testament reading is a reading from Ezekiel. The Lord said to me, O mortal, stand up on your feet, and I will speak with you. And when he spoke to me, a spirit entered into me and set me on my feet, and I heard him speaking to me. He said to me, mortal, I am sending you to the people of Israel, to a nation of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants are impudent and stubborn. I am sending you to them, and you shall say to them, thus says the Lord God, whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that there has been a prophet among them. The word of the Lord. Here endeth the reading. The word of the Lord. The psalm of response is Psalm 123, found in the insert. To you I lift up my eyes, to you enthroned in the heavens. So our eyes look to the Lord our God until he shows us his mercy.
Have mercy upon us, O Lord. Have mercy. For we have had more than enough of the tempters.
Too much of the scorn of the indolent rich and of the derision of the proud. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As was the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
The epistle is a reading from St. Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven, whether in the body or out of the body. I do not know. God knows. I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. Three things I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. Here endeth the epistle. Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done in his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house. And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. And then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over unclean spirits, and he ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals, and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed all that should repent, and they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Please be seated. Risk and reward. I Googled it. Risk and reward. In less than a quarter of a second, I had 32 million hits. It's a big topic. It's mostly about financial markets. Want to make a little money, take a little risk. Want to make big money, then take a big risk. No pain, no gain. But when we're satisfied with the status quo, we'd rather not take risk. We want to play it safe. Why? If it's not broke, don't fix it. Why take the risk? Play it safe. But be careful. Be careful, because safe can cause stagnation. Stagnation is not good. There's a guy who made up a list of 7 steps to stagnation. Number 1, we've never done it that way before. Number 2, we're not ready for that. Number 3, we're doing all right without trying that. Number 4, oh, we tried it once before. Number 5, we don't have the money for that. Number 6, that's not our job. And number 7, something like that can't work. He added that there's probably an 8th step, but he never bothered to look it up. He was so discouraged. We resist taking risks because we are afraid of failing. Failure feels awful. We all know it's not great. But failure is where we learn. Failure is where we grow. I'm a failure. So what? So what? It is far better to have tried and failed than to have done nothing at all. Teddy Roosevelt wrote this. He said, "Far better it is to dare mighty things, to win glorious triumphs even though checkered by failure, than to rank with those poor spirits who neither enjoy nor suffer much because they live in the gray twilight that knows neither victory nor defeat." It's kind of bland. Failure is not the end of the world. Failure is not even the end of life. Failure isn't the end of our effort. In fact, we should expect failure from time to time, because without failure, there wouldn't be 4th quarter or 9th inning or 2 seconds left on the clock thrilling comebacks in sports. Runaway victories are boring. I can remember an election a few years ago when no one turned into the election results because Reagan won his 2nd term. I think the other guy got 3 votes. Nobody cared. But come from behind victories, they're thrilling to watch and they're even better to live. Years ago, there was a college student. He failed all his courses and he was just such a failure. He decided to climb up in the church attic and he hid there for months. He'd sneak downstairs and take clothing out of the bins that were set aside for the rummage sale, and then he would hunt through the leftovers from the potluck suppers, and he lived off of that. And he was just lonely, and he was in isolation. It was awful, and his failure just made him worse and worse and worse. And then one day, they discovered that he was there, the people in the church, and they loved on him, and they said, "It's okay. You can do things. You're good. You're valuable." He was accepted. But somewhere in there, he got this notion, and one that's way too prevalent in our society, that failure is simply unacceptable. But you see, that's not what happened to Jesus when he went back to his hometown, is it? I mean, he stood up to teach in the synagogue, and the people there, who had known him since he was a toddler, were offended. grew up with me. How could he teach me anything? I'm older than him. Isn't this the carpenter? Don't we know his family? I mean, sounds pretty smart, but how could he possibly know more than us? How could he know? He's just a handyman, just a carpenter. I recently heard that an expert is just someone who happens to have a PowerPoint presentation 40 miles away from his house. Jesus' new apparent knowledge and authority made those hometown folks contemptuous. Jesus failed to reveal his power to them because of their unbelief. Only willing to see him as the kid who grew up next door. Noble effort, but Jesus failed. Jesus failed. And if it's okay for Jesus to fail, the Son of the living God, why is it not okay for us to fail? And if it is okay for us to fail, how do we deal with people who thrive on pointing out the obvious? You failed. I know that. Simply to gain credibility with their peers by tearing someone else down. Teddy Roosevelt said, it's not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbled or where the doer of deeds could have done better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes up short again and again, who knows the great enthusiasms, the great devotion, and spends himself in a worthy cause, who at best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at worst, if he fails, at least fails with daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat. If you never risk, never fail, if you never fail, never experienced the fullness of life. Years ago, there was a ship who was running into some rocks off the New England coast, and a young Coast Guard rescuer said, we can't go out, we'll never get back. And the grizzled old captain said, we have to go out. We don't have to come back. We just have to go out. We have to try to save some lives. You see, calm seas do not produce skilled sailors. I imagine those early disciples felt the same kind of fear when Jesus sent them on that first mission trip. Take only the clothes on your back, no bread, no money, no change of clothes, nothing. But he did say, don't go alone. Take someone with you. Rely on each other, counsel each other, work as a team, and they did, and they were enormously successful. Demons cast out, sick people cured, God made known to people. Was there a risk? Oh, you bet. Was there failure? Absolutely. And Jesus told him how to deal with those failures. He said, shake the dust off your feet and move on. Don't let it stick to you. He did not say, let the failures become your identity, for in that you'll have strength. No, he didn't say that. Learn from them and move on. We have the God-given ability to do things differently. We have the power of the Holy Spirit in us. We have the authority given to us in our baptisms. We have the knowledge of God's holy word. And if anyone refuses to recognize that, don't pick a fight with them. Just smile lovingly and move on. George Bernard Shaw said, I learned long ago never to wrestle with a pig. You get dirty, and besides, the pig likes it. Paul captured the essence of that in the letter we heard today. God's power is made perfect in weakness. God's power is perfect in weakness, because if we fail, that power is perfected in us. It is because of our weakness, our insults, hardships, persecutions, calamities, for the sake of Christ, for the advancement of the gospel, that there is room for God in us to grow, thrive. If we were perfect, we wouldn't need God, but we're not perfect, not even close. And so we desperately need God. Too many of us are like that man who rode on the donkey and carried a 200-pound sack of grain on his shoulder as he's riding this donkey. And they, why are you doing that? Why don't you just put the grain on that? He said, oh, I couldn't ask the donkey to carry that. It doesn't make any sense. Have faith. God can carry the weight. God wants to carry the weight. God will gladly lift the burdens from us. All we have to do to make that happen is to take a risk, being understanding that it might not work, that we might fail, that we might not get it right, we can't get it done. But God's there with us through all of that. He'll move us forward. Let us keep going. So open your hearts, let Him in, and then tell some people about God. Tell some people about Jesus. Tell them about how He loves them. And if they reject you, dust off and move on. Please stand as we affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day He rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And He shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church and the world.
Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal Church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love.
Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to Justin, our Archbishop, Michael, our Presiding Bishop, Greg, our Bishop, Robin, Ken, our Priest, John, our Deacon, and for all other bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacrament.
And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life.
We beseech thee also to rule the hearts of those who bear authority and government in this and every land, especially Donald our president, Rick our governor, Walt our mayor, and Rita our county commissioner, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world.
Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty.
And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor especially Ron, Betty, Elaine, Peggy, Marcia, Dan, Andy, Brenda, and all the family of Virginia, and all those in this transitory life that are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. You may add your own petitions at this time.
And we also bless thy name for all thy service to Christ. supported this life by my faith and fear, especially Jenny Morris, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of Gabriel and all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. You may have your own petitions at this time.
Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Ye who do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty. Provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us, we do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This is a true saying, worthy of all men to be received. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the perfect offering for our sins, not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. Please stand. And the peace of the Lord be always with you. You may have noticed in the readings that it ended differently this week than it has been. And I had a meeting with one of your folks this week who, I guess the easiest way to explain it is he longed for a time when the service was more reverent and more serious and more centered on Jesus. And I heard what he said, and I started thinking, well, what cues can we give the congregation so they understand that we really want to move in that direction for this service in particular? And so I went through the prayer book, and I found a couple of things that I thought would kind of give us a little shift in how we see things. And one of those things was to change the response at the end of the Old Testament and New Testament reading. We've been saying, which is the more contemporary version, the older version, the more traditional version, is the other one. And we're also switching to use the oldest chalices that we have in the church. Both of the chalices that we use for the service are from the 1800s. So bringing those traditions, we have the oldest paten is from 1940, as are the vessels. The soborum we use is from the very early, I think it's 1900. But by using those old traditional vessels and the old traditional prayers, I want the service to be a beacon of hope for people who are seeking that kind of service that doesn't exist in our area anymore, that this would be the place that you could come and have that. And so if you have other ideas, I'm open to it. I want to see this service thrive, and I think we can by being different than what everybody else has. Statements for giving are in the back of the church, and you can pick them up there. Please grab one and save us a stamp. That'd be helpful. Karaoke's on vacation. August coming up, we have a Share Your Faith event that we were able to reschedule. Since we originally negotiated to have hosted here, pricing changed significantly, so I went and fought back, and we got our original pricing, because it's now $25 per person for a dance and $35 and no lunch, and so we're doing it for $10 with lunch for our folks, $20 for people from outside. So I got that reset, and so there will be a lunch at the end afterwards. So do consider coming. I talked about afraid of failing, and so we don't like to talk about God to people, and so this might give you a way to have some equip you so that you can actually do it and not be terrified the whole time. Although a little holy care is a good thing. On the back cover, you'll see a picture of Ginny Morris. Ginny Morris passed away on Sunday night last week. Her funeral was yesterday. She was a very faithful member of the congregation. She sang in the choir. She was a piety chair on the Crucio weekends, was active in the Crucio community. And she was also president of the Daughters of the King, a prayer ministry here at the church. And most recently, she has been involved in one of our Living in the Presence groups, Living in the Presence for Caregivers and Care Receivers. She suffered for the last couple of years, and Lamont was with her. And we have a ministry where people who are caregivers come to church on a Thursday afternoon in the parish hall, and we have a faith community nurse who sit with their care receivers, and the caregivers gather around the table, and they can kind of talk and share and figure out how that they can keep moving on in the most difficult times of their lives. So we're grateful for her and how she's helped shepherd so many ministries in the church. Do we have any birthdays this week? It's Priscilla's birthday. Our birthday prayers in your bulletin on page 12. Oh God, our times are in your hand. With favor we pray on your servant Priscilla as she begins another year. Grant that she may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen her trust in your goodness all the days of her life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Happy birthday. Do we have any wedding anniversaries this weekend? This week? Travelers, any travelers? Walk in love as Christ loved us, gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God. Thank you. up your hearts.
Lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty Everlasting God. For with thy co-eternal Son and Holy Spirit, thou art one God, one Lord, in trinity of persons and unity of substance. We celebrate the one and equal glory of thee, O Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord, most high. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute in his holy gospel command us to continue the perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming. From the night in which he died, the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink, eat all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness, vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them, according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, and be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this our sacrifice, praise, and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant, by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins, and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and make one body with him. He may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, pardoning our offenses through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. O Lamb of God that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God that takest away the sins of the world, grant us peace. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table. But thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. This week, Phyllis McLaughlin will be taking communion out into the community. Send you forth. Oh, send you forth, Beth. Is it Cheryl?
Cheryl.
I'm
confused. Why would it be? Okay. Cheryl will do it.
Well, you can do it next week. Cheryl, I send you forth bearing these gifts. We are many, are one, because we share one bread and one cup. Amen. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee that thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporated in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you, and remain with you always. Amen. We stand for our closing hymn. Number 436, we'll sing verses 1 and 5. Please join us for coffee hour.